Engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff.
Hey guys, halfway there to you, with a bit of a different rocket science episode. Today I will cover some of the mistakes so far from previous episodes, as well as adding some additional knowledge. I know this video will probably not get me any new viewers, and I would also like to move on to other topics, since there's so much to cover. However, this video is very important for the integrity of this channel. There's enough pseudoscience all over the internet claiming all kinds of ridiculous stuff, and I don't want my channel to turn into one of those sources, even if I'm just talking about a video game. If you haven't watched my previous videos, please do that first, or you will likely not understand what I'm talking about. Alright, let's get to it. In my first video, I said that boost is a value between 0 and 255. That's not entirely wrong, but only how it gets saved for replays. Furthermore, Psionics actually changed the amount of boost you get per small boost pad, from 11.76% to exactly 12%, in a patch shortly after I released my video. For the people interested in programming, the in-game calculations are done with a regular float value between 0 and 1. And for replays, it gets converted to an 8-bit integer, presumably to reduce the size of replay files. Since the dropshot patch, the values always get rounded downwards, so if your boost meter shows 100, then you will be at max boost. In my video about camera settings, I gave a formula for the real camera distance at supersonic based on the stiffness you set in your settings. At zero stiffness, I estimated the camera to go back an extra 100 unreal units based on screenshot comparisons. Since then, I've learned how to read the real values from the game's memory. Which means I can now tell you that your camera distance will increase by exactly 114.7 unreal units. In that video, there was also a rather important point about the FOV I didn't cover. It is dependent on your aspect ratio. Only on a 16:9 monitor will you actually get the horizontal FOV that you set in the settings. If you are on a 4:3 monitor, the real horizontal FOV will be smaller, and on a 21:9 monitor, it will be larger. Now on to the most important part. In my ball physics video, I talked about the direction the ball will go when you hit it. We knew from a GDC talk by Psionics employee Corey that the game uses a direction pointing from the location of the car towards the location of the ball. Now that sounds like it would be from the center of mass of the car towards the center of the ball. However, when I did some experiments with the center of masses aligned exactly the same but the car slightly tilted, I was getting a different direction. From that, I concluded that the point of impact clearly makes a difference and assumed that Corey must have meant the direction is towards the impact location. However, as a Reddit user pointed out to me, this is a big mistake. If the direction was truly what I said in the video, then the ball should be bouncing to the right and not the left. So I contacted Corey and asked him if he could explain this phenomenon. As it turns out, there's some hacky bit of code causing this. When Psionics went from battle cars to Rocket League, they introduced cars that were a lot longer, which will cause hit directions to be a lot different. In order to give a similar feel, the hit direction gets an adjustment as if the car was shorter without actually making the hitbox smaller. This works exactly like you would expect as long as the car hits the ball flat. At an angle though, it will allow you to deflect the ball more like real physics would. To sum it up, first, the hit direction gets calculated by drawing a vector from the root point of your car towards the center of the ball. Afterwards, this vector gets adjusted by the aforementioned change. And on top of that, the upwards direction will get dampened so the ball doesn't bounce too much when you're trying to dribble. Last but not least, crates. Another Reddit user pointed out to me that my usage of the term confidence interval wasn't quite correct. I said that a 95% confidence interval tells us that the real value is in that range with 95% certainty. But it actually means that for 95% of unbiased samples of that size, the confidence interval will contain the true value. That sounds somewhat the same, but it's slightly different. My calculations were also not accounting for sampling error, but I fixed that in the spreadsheet. On the video, multiple people were commenting that there might be some upload bias, meaning some people might only upload their crate opening if they get good results. While I tried to shy away from small openings, I cannot guarantee 100% that there was no bias in my data. This is why I've started a brand new spreadsheet with very strict rules, where I collect the data structured in a better way, which will hopefully allow me to do some further analysis in the future. For now, the data set is too small to show any conclusive difference. Now at the end, I want to apologize for any confusion I might have caused. I will try my best to avoid any mistakes in the future, and I've gained quite a bit of knowledge since I started, which will help me in that regard. But I cannot guarantee that everything will be flawless. So I invite everyone to double check whatever I put out in hopes of finding the most accurate theories in the end.